morning. Why don't you stand? I'm glad you're here this morning. We're going to have a time of worship. We have Nathan here, and we have Felicia here, and they're going to sing for us, or with us, and lead us into worship. And let's just go ahead and pray, that God bless our time. Lord, I just thank you this morning for your grace, for your goodness in our lives. And I just pray that you anoint our worship. I pray that you be glorified in all of this. Thank you. Would you please be seated? We have some fantastic news. If you came in that way, I think some of you came in that way. We had a Scandium Chapel thrift store. Is that fair to say, Dale? In this family center over here, and we raised right at $1,200 for the shoebox yesterday. And I say, praise God for his provision. And God, we just spent probably two-thirds, between a half and two-thirds. We left some of the things, are still there, and we would like to invite you after church, don't leave now. After church, go and see if there's anything you would like. And I would think that Dad would be willing to give the donation box out if you'd like to make the donation to the two boxes of the appropriate when you want to do that. And otherwise, we're going to load it up. We have plans for King Challenge to come and take the rest to their three stores and so it can continue to be a blessing. But thank you for to all of those who helped and boy, a lot of sweat actually going into that. And thank you very much, and thank you. Also, on Wednesday night is a worship night at Los Angeles Stadium. And we have a video for you, but first, there has been an update. I believe it's something that Kaiser, or even Los Angeles Stadium, has put on them, because they just said that if you're planning to go to this night of worship, you have to get a ticket. Now, the ticket is free, but we posted on Facebook, on the church's Facebook, the site, so that you can register and you download a ticket. And then you have to, and this Kaiser has a rule that they have to know how many you have on the headcount to lose in the stadium. And so, if you would be willing, if you want to sign your goal, you got to have a ticket. The ticket's free, but you got to have a ticket. So don't just show up. You're going to need that ticket to go there to do it. So we're going to show this video, and then we're going to continue to worship. You shall. All right, let's play that video. More songs Here we are to worship.
Thank you.
Jesus, we just praise you this morning and we glorify you. For you are worthy of all praise and glory and honor, Lord Jesus. We bow before you and we praise your name, for you are worthy. For you have conquered death and the grave. You have conquered sin. You have conquered sickness. You are worthy, Lord Jesus, to receive glory and honor. For all things have been placed under your feet. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We do worship you this morning. We bow before you and we glorify you. What a powerful name you have. What a glorious Lord you are. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you have loved us. Thank you, Lord, that you died for us. We bow before you and we praise you this morning. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. You saying that everyone wants time and you said today, that just open your heart to receive Him into your life. Rest in Him. Rest in Him. They can sing that one more time. Bask in His presence, allow Him to envelop you with His love, with His grace, with His healing, with His power. Holy Spirit, you are the one. Jesus, we do bow before you this morning and we praise your name. Holy Spirit, thank you for ministering to us this morning. Thank you for reminding us of the great cloud of witnesses, of the multitudes that bow before you and worship you. Service will teach you. Thank you for the privilege of joining that throng of witnesses. Jesus, we thank you for the mighty work you did yesterday. Thank you that we were able to call people. Lord Jesus, I just pray that you would heal those who need to be touched. I pray for Peyton this morning that you would comfort her. Jennifer, that you would heal her. Lee, Lord, that you would bless him and give him strength in his life. For the Father, that you would give her needs, Lord. For each one who needs physical or emotional or mental or financial need, help, Lord, as long as you minister. For those of us who have contact loved ones, I pray that you would give your mercy and grace in your spirit to convict them of God and to yourself. Lord Jesus, you died for them, you love them. You desire for them to become part of the kingdom of God. And I pray for each of these that you minister to them. I pray for the rest of the church that you be glorified, that you be lifted up. God, please help. Thank you. He refers to the chains that were literal is literally going to be martyred for the cause of Christ. His overall purpose in writing 2 Timothy, and if you're going to read 2 Timothy, look at it through the perspective that Paul knows he's about to die, and he considered Timothy his son in Christ Jesus. And so his purpose was to encourage Timothy in the faith. His purpose was to greet and say farewell to Timothy, because this is probably the last time he would speak to him in this life. And he also wanted to equip him to continue to take charge in every circumstance. This book is, the 2 Timothy, is important for us as well, for it also can teach us, share with us circumstances or ways to have courage regardless of the circumstance that we face. It is important that we also receive encouragement, fellowship with one another. So there are circumstances. Anybody going through any circumstances in which it requires courage? If you're not, just hold out. Hang on for a while. You will. All of us. Jesus said, in this world you will face. So, it's not a, that's not an if, that's a when. Things will test us. Things will buffet us. Things will shake us, distress us. I remember when I was a freshman in college, right before the classes began, they had a fellowship. They got all the freshman class together, and the teachers were all there. And after a while, we're having a good time of introduction and getting to know one another. They tell us all down and said, now our purpose for you is that we trust you. And I thought, oh, my Lord. I thought that Bible school would be fun, you know, there were fun times. But you can't grow unless you're stressed. You don't grow, you don't mature unless there's adversity. But we have to have encouragement. We have to have courage to make it through those times. And if we are not equipped, those times will discourage us and they will threaten us. And that defeats God's purpose in our lives. So Paul gives Timothy five reasons to continue to stand in the faith. Encourage that chapter 2, verses 1 to 3, will use their first. You then, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things you have heard me say in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to reliable people who will also be qualified to teach others. Join with me in suffering like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. Lord Jesus, I thank you this morning for allowing us to be soldiers of the cross. Thank you that you have saved us, redeemed us, and we're your children. Encourage us to enjoy us through this life. I pray that we will stand strong for you. Equip us in your blessing. Last week, we discussed the first two reasons that Paul gave for encouragement. The first are those examples that God has placed in our lives. The heritage that we stand upon. Hebrews 12 says, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us stand firm. But they're not just Isaac and Abraham and Jacob and Noah and David, and those are great examples of how to stand strong. Paul here in 2 Timothy says, join me in standing strong. The example of Jesus standing strong. But just even more than that, for you have had people in your life who are good examples of what it means to stand strong. My son yesterday, he calls me up and he says, I just drove by a sign. And then I have it's the Congress of 62. 62 that had a high school reunion. He says, I've been married. He's only 7 years since I'm here. They called me. 60 years they've graduated from high school. You know what? Maybe some of you even past 60 years. You're great examples of what it means to stand strong in Jesus Christ. I see some of you here, and you are an encouragement to me. And I've been standing for Christ now for about 50 years, but nobody got me beat. There are those in the room that if you'll look at them, they are good examples of what it means to stand strong, to have courage in Christ Jesus. A heritage of those who encourage us along the way. And we are benefited by taking courage from that inheritance, from that heritage. Those pastors or teachers or friends who start to stand strong in Christ, if your parents are or were godly people, to stand strong in Christ as they were or are. Good examples. But Paul goes on to say the second reason we have for courage is that we have a hope to say. We have a hope to say. Some of you are not going to be impressed by this. I'm very excited because football season is going to start in a few weeks. Some of you go, who cares? Who cares? I don't care. Well, I have a hope that my team is going to win. I have a hope they're going to win. That's not much of a hope. But you and I have a real hope that we have confidence to share. We have the hope of Jesus Christ and salvation that is only found in Him. We have a mission, and it's not a fool's mission. We are not simply a social club. Do you realize we're not a social club? Oh, we're going to have a potluck after today. But we're not a social club. We're the church of Jesus Christ. And we're marching on to glory. And we have a hope and a hope to share. We are soldiers of the cross commissioned by King Jesus Himself that nothing should stop us from executing our mission. And you say, well, what's our mission? It's in faithfully reaching the world for Him. Now, in the media lately, in some circles, they now view the church as being some radical group that's going to rise up and pick up our guns and start shooting everyone. No, that is not our mission. No. I've even heard the terms of radical evangelism, evangelical. Well, I'm a radical evangelical, except I'm not going to pick up a gun, but I might pick up a Bible. And when we talk about Jesus, we should be radical evangelicals, but not like the world says. Because King James has commissioned us to share again with a lost and dying world. We have a hope. It's not just a social problem. But the third reason for courage is actually found in chapter 2 of 2 Timothy 2. He says, you then, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. You then, be strong in the grace. The reason for courage is the grace of God. The grace of God is a phenomenal thing. You stand in the grace of God. God's grace is every reason for us to have courage. You consider for a moment what God has accomplished in your life. You consider what He's done in your life. Just today, you accepted Him as your Savior. All of that has been accomplished through His grace. When you consider the blessings He has poured into your life,
You know, when you start feeling down and you start feeling a little critical or pain, you're not a pity party. Doom, despair, agony on me. Anybody ever do that? Well, start counting the blessings of God in your life. There are many. There are many. And they're all due to the grace of God in your life. When you start to consider His salvation and how once we were dead in our sins, but now we're alive in Christ. Oh, wow, what a blessing. That we're no longer headed to hell, we're headed to heaven. Oh, what a blessing. When you consider His healing in our lives. Have you ever been healed by God? I have. Well, praise God. His leading in our lives. His provision in our lives. When we start to consider those things and the grace of God that is so evident in our lives, we're able to stand strong. It is the same grace. It is the same grace that saved us. Some of us are really worried about what's going to happen tomorrow. You don't have to worry about tomorrow. Do you know why? God. No, what the Lord doesn't take care of himself. God takes care of tomorrow. The same grace that has saved you and kept you is waiting for you tomorrow. God would say to you this morning, don't be upset, don't be worried, don't be troubled. I got this. I got this through His grace. Whatever we are going to face today, God's grace is sufficient. I'm not even smart enough that I know necessarily what's going to happen tomorrow, this afternoon. But God does, and in His grace is sufficient. Whatever challenges come our way, God's grace is sufficient. Everything lately has been talking about the thorn that Paul had in his side, and he asked God to take the thorn. And God's answer is, my grace is not wise, is sufficient. So if you have difficulties tomorrow, guess what? God's grace is there for you tomorrow, but tomorrow will be due today. You can't really worry about the time of the rest, but God's grace is there as well. And the day after, and the day after. We cannot exhaust the grace of God. You will not exhaust the grace of God or the power of God or the authority of God or the love of God. The grace of God is always sufficient. Just as God told Moses at the burning bush, Moses is going to ask, so who should I say? And he said, many of God said, tell me that I am sufficient. Because God just is. God just is. The attributes of God carry the same as God does. So God's grace just is. It's not was, it's an is. It's ever the same. God's love, ever the same. God's mercy, ever the same. God's power, ever the same, is eternal because God's eternal. Now, I have heard people like this sat before me. They're married, but they're in trouble. The marriage is on the rocks. And I don't love them anymore. I've heard people say that. Sure. You will never hear that from God, though, because God's love is forever. He is. So just as God is without sin, God God's present peace is so His attributes, His grace is without count. It is always sufficient for the time. That's why we can sing songs like standing on the promises of Christ my Savior. Because His promises are true. They're sure. Heaven and earth will pass away, but God's Word will never pass away, because it's the eternal Word of God. Now, there is a danger. There is a danger of someone who said, I'm standing on the promises of God, by standing on the promises. We're supposed to stand on the promises, not sit in the premises. Amen? Four things are found in chapter 2, verses 8 to 10. Remember, Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from heaven and David. This is my gospel for which I am suffering, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. For God's word is not changed. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they too may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. Here is the first word of saying. We don't have this one for you. If we died with Him, we'll go also live with Him. Amen? If we endure, we will also reign with Him. Amen? I don't like this necessarily. If we disown Him, He will also disown us. Oh. If we are faithless, He remains faithful, for He cannot disown Himself. Take courage, stand strong in the faith. So there is a prize for us to reach for. We have courage based on the Word of God, for God's Word is not changed. Paul at that point was changed, but God's Word is never changed. God's Word is never defeated. God's Word is not weak. Rather, God's Word is alive and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. It can change the soul. Change my soul and yours as well. As an example, Paul cites the greatest part of the Word. Jesus Christ crucified. Is the centerpiece of all of creation, all history, circles around that one event. Jesus Christ, crucified, raised again. The center of history. Yes, most people look at the center of history, they give a different answer. But that is the center of history. Glorified and coming again. We can have courage for the Word of God to share that Jesus Christ is alive forevermore. He is not a dead martyr. He is the living King. Bill last night in prayer was talking about Elvis, the King. There was a show last night about Elvis. You know what the problem is, though? Elvis is dead. We serve the living King. And He's not only the living King, He's the King of Kings. Really talking about whether King Jesus can sing like Elvis. I think He probably can. Because He's the King of Kings. We have courage for the Word of God says that Jesus is coming again. You know, the world is taking turns, it's upside down. But we can have courage because we have read in God's Word that in the end, God wins. We know the end. We know the end, so why do we get so upset? God has shared with you what the end is. So take courage. Take courage. For we have the Word of God. And the Word of God is able to equip us to stand strong in God, which leads us to the final reason we have to pray. And it's found in chapter 4, verses 1 to 5. In the presence of God, we call you, Amen, Christ Jesus. Who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing in his kingdom. I give you this charge, preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage. You that I have been called to encourage one another. You do know that, right? With great praise, because I feel like it comes in. We want to encourage, but we want them to do what we say and apply those things immediately. Well, but sometimes it takes patience and careful instruction. So the time will come when people will not put up a sound doctrine and start to see their own desires. They will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their engineers want to hear. They will turn away their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myth. But you keep your head in all situations, endure hardships, do the work of an evangelist, discharge all the duties of your ministry. When Jesus comes, we want to be found doing exactly what he told us to do. You'll be guilty of doing exactly what he has told you to do. As we have said over the past week, we are part of the body of Christ, and as part of the body of Christ, we each have something to do for God. I want to be found doing exactly what he has given me to do. In fact, wouldn't it be great if he showed up right now? Doing what he has told us to do. We can have courage, according to this, if we are properly prepared. I have a teacher in my school that used to say, take time, he said, the greatest time is prayer, the greatest time that people pray, that students pray, is right before the new test. And they're praying that the Holy Spirit would help them answer those questions. But you can't ask the Spirit to remind you of His Word unless you put His Word in your heart or your mind in the first place. He can't remind you of things you haven't minded in the first place. The Spirit is faithful to remind us. But it takes study of God's Word, preparation of God's Word, meditating, memorizing God's Word, so that at the proper time God can bring His Word to our minds. Amen? Preparation. Planning. I have a lot of times it takes a question, a conversation starter. You know, there's a conversation starter to tell somebody about Jesus. Often you can't just go up to somebody and say, can I tell you about Jesus? You know, it works sometimes, but you probably need a conversation starter. So I was thinking about it, and I had come up with a conversation starter. You know what? It works pretty good. Let me tell you about it. When I'm around an older person and they say, you know, getting old is hard, or something of that nature. And they're referring about their, you know, aches and pains. I say, well, it's better than your current. better than an alternative, but that's a loaded question. I was in Bible the other day, and there were these older people in the line to check out, and they were talking about getting old, and it's hard to give a whole nine shows, but it's better than the alternative. And they said, well, I'm not going down there, I'm going up there. Okay? But a lot of people think that they're going up there because they're a good person, or that they're American. It's a perfect opportunity, and I said to him, are you going because you did well, or because of your work, or are you learning because you believed on the Lord Jesus Christ? And now the conversation is starting. It works. But it takes preparation to think that through, or thought that through, and know how that conversation proceeds. Because people have a perception that all people go to heaven and not all people do go to heaven. You only go to heaven if you've accepted Christ. So to ask that when you accepted Christ. If you haven't, then you're not going to heaven. You're going. That's just something I'm trying to do. I would encourage you to prepare so that you have something similar, so that you also can share Christ with others. Don't rely off the top of your head. If you're like me, I think of a lot of things to say later. Don't you? You're sitting at home, oh, I wish I would have thought to say that. I would even encourage you to practice your testimony of telling people what Jesus has done in your life. What's the conversation gets to that? You have to practice it in front of the mirror. Practice it. Practice it in front of your husband or wife, your children, your dog. Your dog is sitting there listening to you. Rally their father. We are to have courage, and we can have courage. Good soldiers of the cross. Faithfully administering the mission that He gave us to do. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you this morning. I thank you this morning for your grace, and I thank you, Lord, that you have loved us. And thank you for the courage that we can have in you. Thank you, Lord, that we can be equipped despite all the circumstances. Lord, I just pray that you would bless each other. I pray that you minister to each other. Cause us to realize our need of you. We need you. Lord, without you, we are nothing. Would you stand with us for me and let's sing? Thank you. Teach us, Lord, how to remain in you, abiding in you. Remembering that without you, we can do nothing. But in you, Lord, we can do all things. Lord Jesus, I pray that you bless this morning, teach this morning. I pray that you would cause us to leave this place this morning with courage. But not courage on our own, but courage that only comes from the Spirit of you. Lord, I pray that you bless the food with the deep water that we glorify in the fellowship of the God. God bless you. Have a good afternoon.